graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Terra Ignota, Seven Surrenders, Part 2 by Ada Palmer, narrated by Chris Stinson, and performed by a full cast.
Casimir, you must let me pour you a drink.
Felix Faust lifted a crystal decanter from the sideboard.
I never expected you to get this far. What a wonderful world we live in, where even I can be surprised.
Thanks, Headmaster. That's kind of you.
European Prime Minister Casimir Perry had stood timidly at the threshold of the Salon des Sardes, as if afraid the ivory carpet would blacken under an outsider's feet. He scanned the oval ring of seats, all empty.
Where is everyone?
Fair question. You're the guest of honor tonight and should have arrived last, so we could cheer you across the threshold.
Faust poured himself a glass as well.
In fact, the rest of us were asked to get here 20 minutes ago. It seems there's crisis enough afoot to have all the other hive heads running late.
But not you?
Perry fidgeted with his embroidered cuffs, fresh from Madame's tailors.
Unlike our colleagues, I delegate Gordian's entire administrative burden, so while I may be surprised by this delicious crisis, I am not expected to do much about it. Shall we sit?
Faust gestured to the velvet window bench. Madame and her servants had outdone themselves for this occasion, transforming the oval sanctum from an earthly to a celestial paradise. Fawn-thin tables stood against the walls, lush with sweet meats and covered platters alluring as unopened presents. If roast beasts and flame-grilled hunks on spits are a man's feast, this was a woman's. Intricate patisserie, ribbon candy delicate as jewelry, chocolate truffles, bite-sized cakes, and bouquets of fruit sliced so thin that the light shone through their juicy petals like stained glass. The benches had been restuffed, virgin sheepskins piled on the floor, while the tools of love in their glass cases, both the museum pieces and those ready for use, gleamed clean. Even the curtains over the grand window were new, night blue, glittering with constellations, which made the masses in the flesh pit below seem as distant as mortals glimpsed by Zeus and Hera. Perry stared into his glass.
I'd rather stand.
My dear Casimir, this bench has the most interesting view in the world. There's a more telling cross-section of humanity down there than in the census database plus porn. How can you possibly prefer to stand? You're nervous?
Of course.
Faust smiled.
The entire European Parliament doesn't make you nervous.
The European Parliament can't deny me sexual satisfaction for the rest of my life. Aren't you nervous around Madame?
Only when I'm sober.
How did they do this to us, Felix? I was too young to understand when I got sucked in. But you're a psychologist. You must have watched it closely. Here we are, the most influential people in the world, prancing around in frills because it's the only way we can get turned on anymore.
Perry ran his thumb around his glass, coaxing a soft note from the crystal.
Madame lured us all into this long before we were important. But how did they know we'd become what we are now? Are they really able to spot the ones who are ripe for this perversion when we're young? And then make sure only we can get into office? Or is everybody this kind of pervert deep inside, and it's just Madame that brings it out in us?
Faust crossed his arms.
Now don't give Madame all the credit. Some of us cultivated excellent perversions on our own.
I know you did, Felix. But Briar Kosala, the Emperor, The King of Spain is the most morally upright person I've ever met. But even Spain...
That didn't stop you hiring Zivenresa to knock Spain out of the election.
Perry went white.
Don't worry. I haven't discussed it with the others, and I won't, without good cause.
How did you know?
I'm Brillist Headmaster Casimir. How do I know anything? Don't worry, I won't blackmail you. I couldn't really. Body language isn't proof enough for court.
I thank you.
My point was, you took advantage of Spain's honorability, knowing they'd resign if someone tried to fix the vote on their behalf. You know, in Spain's case, conscience is a weakness.
Again, Perry's eyes escaped into the amber ocean of his drink.
I never said I wasn't the worst of us, Felix. I shudder to list the things I've done to get to this room today. I think I was a good person when I was young. I really do.
Think of our perversions as topiary. We all had the seeds in us, but it's Madame who made them art. Now, shall I have Mycroft fetch you something to fuck while we wait? The others are so set in their configurations, the two threesomes and the pair, that usually our debauches aren't very debauched, I'm afraid. I've been looking forward to you changing that.
Is that Mycroft Canner?
Perry spotted me now in Jehovah's empty corner, my dull Franciscan habit, anti-camouflage, against the sparkle of the house. Faust's eyes rarely grow wide.
You haven't met?
I heard about Canner turning up as a servicer a couple days ago and stalking Tully Mardy. I guessed Madame must be connected to it somehow. That's Mycroft Canner, isn't it? I recognize the notch out of their ear.
Faust summoned me with a flick of his fingers.
Poor outsider. The only one who's had to make do without Mycroft's services all these years. To be strict, though, it isn't through Madame's good offices that we have Mycroft. It's thanks to our excellent and unique prince, Jehovah Epicurus Donatien Darue Mason. Which name will you use for our dear scion now, Perry? As one of Madame's elite, you are entitled to use something more personal than the prince Darue, but you must pick carefully. Everyone is judged by which they use. Dibs on Donatien.
Dibs? Why do you get dibs on one?
As one of the candidates in the initial debate over who the child's father was, I got to contribute a name. But you weren't around 21 years ago. Tough luck.
Perry did not answer, for I had drawn close enough to be inspected. His face grew slack before me, a distanced awe, like a child gaping at a cobra in a zoo.
Incredible. Madame really does collect the worst of us.
29 years?
Screams passed through the closed paneled doors.
Cry out! It's not as if I conspired against you personally.
29 years you've been controlling the CFB and you've never said a word to me?
Her Excellency, Cousin Chairwoman, Briar Kosala.
Kosala burst in, a tidal wave of satin and accusations.
You knew! And now you're too coward to show your face.
My lord, the Comte de Guise.
This title heralded not a man, but two servants wielding a chassis. A mannequin lounged in it, sporting a coat of green velvet, a burgundy-violet waistcoat, a strip of black mask, and, through speakers, the voice of the anonymous.
Briar, be sensible. You know I'm not hiding from you, I'm hiding from the outsider. You expect me to reveal myself now, of all times?
Faust laughed, even as Perry scowled.
It's not as if I actively conspire to take control of the CFB. It's Danae and Julia Doria Pamphili you should be angry at. They're the ones who actually tried to take it away from me and use it for their own ends. I didn't take it to abuse it, and really, I didn't take it at all. I inherited it.
Inherited?
Exactly. This isn't about us, Briar. The Anonymous has directed the CFB for over a century, and I've been the Anonymous a lot longer than we've been together.
And that's supposed to make me feel better? Not only has a person I love been secretly dictating my political actions for 30 years, but other people I didn't even know were doing it before them.
The mannequin's bearers fled before Briar's wrath, like hounds from a whip, leaving the chassis and toy Anonymous to plead alone.
What was I supposed to do? Is that a system either of us could fix?
How about, by the way, darling, your life is a lie?
Faust smiled. The bouquets of lace and satin which dripped from the half-sleeves of Kosala's gown were not cut to accommodate the brandishing of fists.
Felix, I swear, if the words I knew the whole time come out of your mouth, I'll show you something your numbers say I shouldn't be capable of. Probably involving my foot and bits of you that don't want to meet it.
I can see why Madame wanted Mycroft here to chaperone tonight. Mycroft, pour the chairwoman a glass of sherry, would you? That's a good monster. Perry, care for seconds?
Perry?
Briar only now realized that the quiet figure half screened by tiers of canopies was neither Spain nor Mason.
Why didn't you tell us Perry was already here?
Sorry, this is coming on an awkward night.
I had never seen Briar's eyes so cold. Perry managed not to wince.
Good to see you, Chair Kosala. I know you know this already, but you look wonderful in a dress.
He paused, hoping for a smile. None came.
And that's the Anonymous over the intercom? It's an honor to meet you, Monsieur le Comte.
Prime Minister Perry gave ample pause, but the voice behind the puppet did not stir.
I realize it will take you longer than the others to trust me, but I can't tell you how thrilling it is to actually be able to talk to you, negotiate with you, get input. I've admired you my whole life. You are the voice of sense in all this.
The Prime Minister paused, his tense hands fidgeting with the buttons on his pocket flaps.
And you control the CFP. That's strange news. It's not a problem if you're a cousin, but you're not a cousin, are you?
That matter is not for you to worry about. It is between Chair Kosala and myself, understood?
Yes.
Yes, my Lord Count. The forms don't all drop just because you're inside, Mr. Prime Minister.
Of course, Headmaster. My apologies.
His Grace, Ganymede Jean-Louis de la Tremorie, Duc de Tours, Prince de Talmond, President of the Humanists, with His Excellency, Chief Executive Director, Hotaka Ando Mitsubishi, and Her Highness, Donna A. Marie Anne de la Tremouille, Mitsubishi, Princess de Tremouille, et de Talmond.
Perry staggered at the sight, and his gaping face glowed in the light reflected by Donna A.'s kimono, which shimmered with the subtle mingling colors of the dawn, each thread awakened to brightness by the reflections from Ganymede's gold as he pressed against her, careful as a guide dog. Ando, on her other side, had one arm locked around her waist, the loose black of his formal hakama and kimono darkening his limbs like storm clouds. Even I staggered.
You're sure you want to do this?
Ganymede settled his sister onto a sofa with meticulous care, like a gardener transplanting roses.
You don't have to stay tonight if you don't want to.
I should be here.
She pulled the pair of them down around her, like shells around a tender scallop.
Oh, I must greet our guest.
No starving man has ever stalked a loaf of bread so fixedly as Perry's eyes locked on Donna A.
I hope I'm more than just a one-night guest, Princess. But are you all right? You seem unwell.
My wife is tired.
Her husband sat forward, blocking as much of Donna A as possible from the outsider's view.
That is all. Mycroft, brandy.
I delivered the glass to the Duke, who held it as his sister alternated between timid sips and resting her head against his golden coat. No, tonight's coat was something more than gold. Have you ever seen yellow diamonds, reader? The sunburst brightness of them mocks gold. I have spoken with several doctors, hoping one could identify this prescient illness, which affected Donna A before the day's dooms showed their faces. One proposed anemia, another that she sensed the anxieties of her adopted children. But I suspect it is simply a sensitivity, like orchids, or old men's knees which tremble at the scent of danger in fate's breath. The skill is natural enough in this creature, who maintains herself ever on exhaustion's threshold, so her favorite weapons, hysteria and fainting, remain keen.
His Majesty, Isabel Carlos II, King of Castile, of Aragon, of Leon, of Galicia, of Granada, of the Canary Islands, of...
We will forgive the King of Spain if tonight, of all nights, he did not have the patience to wait through his full list of titles before entering. He nodded in juridocratic order to the others, but all these he passed, stopping only at Perry.
Welcome inside, Prime Minister.
He offered his hand.
You have worked very hard to get here. I hope to see that energy do the world much good.
Perry trembled as he took the king's hand.
Thank you, Your Majesty. I doubt you can believe me, but I'm sorry I had to come here at your expense. I have far more respect for you than for anyone else who's ever set foot in this room.
Careful.
And I hope I'm right that you will see brighter days when this is over.
Spain accepted the glass of manzanilla I had waiting for him.
Thank you, Prime Minister. Membership in this circle represents a common hope that we with power may do more good for the world as colleagues than as adversaries. I hope you will embrace that.
Duke President Ganymede is never so cross as when he is forced to sit through the titles of a true king.
If Your Majesty wants Perry to dig their claws out of your heir, you should just beg and have done.
Ganymede!
Ondo scolded the Duke as Donna A dug reproachful fingers into her brother's lace.
Spain is not our enemy.
No, but dynastic troubles are. If Perry really meant well by His Majesty, he'd get his claws out of the Crown Prince. Do you know how many knights this month Leonor Valentin has...
His Imperial Majesty, Cornel Mason, Princeps Senatus, Pater Patriae, Precis Maximus, Dictator Perpetus, Imperator Moisarcus, and Madame Daraway.
The hostess entered on the Emperor's arm, the breadth of her skirts keeping him at a civil distance. Mason always seems grim at Madame's. His suit of imperial gray transformed from grave to ominous as military flaps and cording replace the plain Masonic cut. Today, the darkness spread to Madame as well. The salmon damask of her gown trimmed with festoons of black lace, as when a state funeral fills a mourning city with its trappings. Madame's face, however, offered a perfect portrait smile.
Dearest friends, you are, you know, my dearest friends in the world. I cannot say how much it means to me to have you all gathered around me like this. I like to think this little world I have created enables communication which would otherwise be segregated by the walls that protocol erects between us. Here, you are friends, not governments. You can speak honestly, care, cooperate, help each other as friends should, with patience and compassion, instead of laws and faceless treaties. I hope to see you all remain friends tonight, setting aside the personal allegiance and vendetta to help each other weather these grave days.
Madame, you shouldn't share other people's secrets with the company without asking them. I don't want...
Madame shushed the cousin chair with an open palm.
I was not speaking of your situation, Briar. We are, all of us, I think,
aware that something is threatening the cousins. We love you, Briar. Not just déguisé. We all love you. And owe you and your cousins an incalculable debt for your help and charity and most humane activities around the world. You know you have but to ask for help for it to be yours. And the time for that will come soon. But for the moment, I was not speaking of your troubles, but of something graver.
Her eyes turned on the outsider with a glistening and fragile sympathy.
I am sorry, Prime Minister, to load crisis upon you on your first visit. This should have been a time for you to enjoy the warmth of friendship, not to see it tested right away.
Perry nodded stiffly.
It is all right, Madame. I did not join this company for the company. Go on.
Tears of gratitude sparkled in the corners of her eyes.
There is no one in this room, our newcomer aside, who was not, at some point, employed my son, not in the individual offices he serves for each of you, but as a polylaw. He investigates what no other can be trusted to investigate, and we rely on him to settle in secret what is best kept secret. He has found an exception.
An exception in whose opinion, madame? Yours?
She shook her head.
Yours. We all drafted the rules together of what crimes were too great to remain concealed, even if exposure might harm the common weal. Remember, friends. We are friends.
His Imperial Highness, the Prince Darroway.
Are you surprised the crier stops short, reader? That no encyclopedia of titles trails after Jehovah's name? A list of his offices in every hive would fill a paragraph, and with his full name and the styles bestowed by his pedigree, the list would outstrip Mason's and approach Spain's. I think in early days, it was Madame who chose not to remind each power how many others laid claim to the child, but it is now Jehovah's preference. He is offended enough by the time it takes to move from one location to another and cannot stand to lengthen the delay. Jehovah entered smoothly, his suit pure black as always. Black buttons, black lace, black striped miner's sash, even the embroidered vine work, black on black and restful to the eye like shadow.
The illusion that humanity is capable of peace is over.
Doubt and fear shot from eye to eye around the room. Hyperbole does not come from his lips.
What do you mean, Epicuro?
It was Spain who spoke first, least shaken, perhaps because all the others had secrets enough to fear that he referred to theirs.
For 244 years, peace between the hives has been maintained by the humanists and Mitsubishi. By employing the Senior Weeks Booth Transportation Network as an assassination system. Europe joined the conspiracy 120 years ago. The victims total 2,204. Your long supposed peace is made of murder. The 710 list theft was engineered to lead us to this truth.
How fiercely all in the room wished they could imagine that Jehovah would joke.
What is this, Jet? An assassination system? You mean criminals inside the hives are...
The hives themselves. Their leaders.
He looked at no one, but his gaze seemed to accuse the air itself and all who breathed it.
Whom have they been killing?
Jehovah turned slow eyes upon his imperial father.
Human beings.
Why?
World stability.
You have proof?
Yes.
Behind Jehovah, the crier announced,
The Honorable Mycroft Guildbreaker, Praesis Minor, Nepos Imperatoris, Familiaris Regni, Minister Porphyrogenis, and the Reverend Father Dominic Seneschal.
The two wore the formal livery Madame had designed for this room. Dominic had his black suit, Martin a light gray uniform, corded and military to match his emperor's, with white cording on his right shoulder to represent the white sleeve of his Ordo Vitae Dialogorum. The pair brought printed lists on paper and handed one to each power within the room, ready to be kept forever as evidence or destroyed at once, as the holder willed.
Who knew about this? It's some low-level conspiracy, right? It can't have been the leaders. They...
She winced as she found her eyes already straying to Ando and Ganymede.
You didn't know, right? Ando?
Would he have tried to lie, I wonder, had he not raised his eyes to find Jehovah's staring at him? Men tell me that Jehovah's eyes look dead, a blackness which focuses on nothing and reflects nothing, lightless as the emptiness of space. They must, I think, be atheists who say this, for to me, the black of heaven that we see beyond the stars is more alive than anything.
This system is older than its current leadership. Remember that. We inherited this, one of the powers of our offices. We could no more abandon it than you could throw away that black sleeve, Mason.
Caesar's eyes fell to his left hand.
Have you killed Masons?
1,021 Masons, 782 Cousins, 256 Brillists, 28 Hiveless, and 117 Europeans in the years before Europe joined the conspiracy.
I want Ando to answer, Feely.
Never let it be said that the Mitsubishi chief director cannot meet Caesar's iron gaze.
I have a duty to my hive as you do, Mason. This is part of it.
Perry chimed in.
That's right. It's like the Emperor's duty to torture their successor, or how the Déguisés inherited all the duties of the Anonymous, even the shady ones.
He avoided Briar's hot glance.
We didn't create this system. You think we want the world to be dependent on murder?
I spotted tears in Spain's eyes.
You knew, Prime Minister.
Perry forced himself to face the king.
Yes, Your Majesty. I've known for years, ever since I was appointed to the Special Means Committee. That's what we do. The committee was created 120 years ago by the sub-ministers that made the deal to join this three-way alliance. It's been so good for Europe, you can't possibly imagine. The committee existed to let Europe participate in the system without the knowledge of the Prime Minister, to protect you and your predecessors from involvement with the assassinations because...
Because His Catholic Majesty goes to confession.
Kosala could hardly keep herself from ripping the paper in her shaking hands.
You mean because Spain has a conscience, unlike some.
Conscience? My conscience could not be clearer. Thousands, perhaps millions of lives are saved by every war we stop. All your charities have never given so much as a band-aid to so many.
War?
War, Briar. Riots, slaughter, death. Déguisé can tell you they watch the numbers more closely than any of us. How many close calls have we had, Déguisé? How many ripples in the hive balance that would have exploded if something invisible hadn't tipped us back from the brink?
The self-correction. It's to do.
The words rose from the Anonymous's mannequin.
That's what the self-correcting push is. I noticed it. I didn't understand it until now, but the worst of the trends always reset, settle down just before the point of no return. I always worried about recessions in the past, economic contraction, but since Sniper shared Tully Marty's speech at Ingolstadt this morning, I realized the ripples have been threatening something a lot worse than a recession. The Ives are not as friendly to each other as we like to think. It's true. It has been stopping war.
What are you saying? That it's okay? That they should get away with murdering thousands of people?
Of course not. And certainly not in secret to further the Hive's interests against the others. They've been doing that too. I can see it now. The inexplicable resets always favor those three Hives.
That's what matters to you most? Hive bias? Then I suppose it would have been okay if they did it for everyone equally.
We did.
Ondo's declaration brought not only Briar's glare, but everyone's.
A ship that aboards too much cargo will sink, however strong. The Masons have benefited from this as much as we have. So have your cousins. We can even save your CFB now if you like. We have a plan ready. We were going to do it for you in the spirit of goodwill, but if you'd rather we let you fall apart...
Would you expect the lady to threaten tears here, Rita? That Kosala did, but she threatened fists as well. Headmaster Faust glanced up from reading.
I have students on this list.
Director Ando nodded acknowledgement.
Not as many as you would have lost in wars.
Faust glared.
I was talking to the system's creator, Ando, not to you.
The system is 300 years old, Felix. Its creators are long dead.
The old headmaster shook his head.
Not their ideas. The humanists created this. No one else sees history as composed of individuals. On their own, the Mitsubishi would target corporations. Masons, governments, Europe, nation-strats, me, Bashes, the anonymous ideas. Only the humanists still think the world is made of individuals. Ganymede, you can't pretend you aren't the heart of this.
The Duke President had sat detached, giving the papers a half-skim as he continued to soothe his trembling sister.
This list is just names.
He looked to Jehovah.
Does your highness have more exact proof?
Even in such crisis, his grace does not forget the title due to an emperor's son.
Not yet, your grace. But the Commissioner General is close to proof.
Ganymede's lips pursed for a moment. A stifled wince, perhaps?
The Commissioner General? How many of their staff know?
Kosala's face grew dark.
Ganymede? You still haven't answered if you knew.
The Duke crossed his arms, the yellow diamond fabric flashing like the sun without its warmth.
A leader is responsible for the actions of his hive, regardless of personal involvement. Even if I didn't know, if my hive is guilty, then I am. So are Ando, Perry, His Majesty, and all others who have led our hives in the last 3 centuries.
He waited for Spain to nod.
But blame can wait. What matters now is that we stop the police from exposing this without warning and throwing the world into...
Denetian, is Ganymede a murderer?
It had to be asked. But all eyes, even Faust's, flinched slightly in the silence before Jehovah's answer.
You are all murderers. You and your whole world. We had thought that... if humanity left the trees far enough behind, you could leave the war of all against all with them. We were wrong.
I sobbed here. So did Caesar. The sob stifled stillborn in his throat like a too hard swallow. He saw it too, I think. The specter of Apollo stirring in Jehovah's words like a harmonic, played by no one, but rising unbidden from the perfection of a chord. We will never be free of you, will we, Apollo? We had not heard these words since Death and I extinguished what we thought was the vital part of you. Yet here we hear your voice again, the stronger, since it rises from his lips.
Mycroft, is Ganymede a murderer?
Stares tortured me for 3 long seconds. Yes, Caesar. Yes, he is. Should I not have answered him? I have thought long about it. By law, I must answer the Emperor. But it is by choice that we obey or break the law. It is not as if I think the Duke's guilt would not have come out had I stayed silent. but the choice won me another enemy. Until that moment, Ganymede had thought all the powers were equally my master. Caesar no more than he, all second to Jehovah. Now, he knew otherwise. The Duke does not forgive in general, and certainly not me.
Would you like a copy of the list, Princess?
Martin and Dominic had not brought a copy for the lady, but an aide had followed them in, sliding quietly around the back in a monk's habit, much like mine, dull as dust against the gold. Smiling her silent thanks, Donna A reached for the list, then screamed and slipped into a lifeless faint.
Donna!
Husband and brother cried her name together.
It's true, isn't it?
The aide's hood fell back to reveal a red, seething face.
Danae is my mother.
Carlisle Foster.
I barely had time to throw myself between the Duke and Senseiya before Ganymede seized a dagger-long pin from Danae's golden hair and lunged.
I kill you, parasite. You stay away from my sister. Away!
The steely needle inched close to my throat, while the Duke's other hand raked me with fingers fierce as talons. Better me than Carlisle.
You planned all of this, didn't you?
I seized the Duke's wrists, sleek as ivory, and forced him back until Ando could grasp him from behind.
Ganymede, control yourself. The child didn't plot this. They know nothing.
The Duke strained against our grips, his gold mane bright as fire against Ando's black.
Get that creature out of here, and I want whoever let it in here flogged. No, bring the one responsible to me. I'll do it with my own hands.
Lounging against the shelves of toys and Plato in Jehovah's corner, Dominic could not entirely suppress a smile.
Carlisle, come with me.
Kosala reached for the Sensei's shoulder.
You should be here.
Don't tell me I shouldn't be here, Che Kosala.
Carlisle slapped Kosala's hand away like an intruding insect.
I'm the one who gave Papadelius the evidence to expose this whole conspiracy. I'm the one who was almost killed last night by Fisbee Sunir trying to cover it up. I'm the one all of you have been trying so hard to keep in the dark, even you! When we met here before, you told me you were just here as an outside inspector. You lied.
Briar had a few inches on Carlisle and used them, glaring down with the stern authority of teacher, queen, and mom combined.
It's my job to protect you and yours to listen to me. I wish you had.
I was happy as a gag, Jean. I didn't want to know. But I was trying to save you and the CFB. This is the price I paid.
Carlisle winced, feeling tears leak.
You can't leave me with half the truth. I was born here, wasn't I? I'm part of this. I won't call it a barsh.
Please wait outside for me. I'll come as soon as I can. But we have more important things to do.
No, we don't.
Cornell!
Foster may be a cousin, Briar, but that doesn't make this your decision. I am the Praesus Maximus. I guard the list of gag genes in the Sanctum Sanctorum, and if anyone had told me Carlisle Foster had set foot in this house, I would have summoned them at once to warn them of the danger. It's too late now.
He stepped a short pace toward Kosala, his limp as bad as I had ever seen.
Foster is in pain, Briar. The greatest pain they've ever experienced. Nothing else is urgent enough to justify extending that.
I know, Cornell. I just... not here in front of everyone.
Why not?
Carlisle's eyes shot from power to power. These distant faces seen so many times on screens.
Why not in front of everyone? I get the feeling I'm the only person in this room who doesn't know.
I did not know, but did not contradict.
What do you know already?
Carlisle looked to the princess curled on the couch.
Danae is my mother. Is anyone going to deny that?
All stayed silent.
And my father was some rival of Director Ando's for Danae's hand, yes?
Carlisle's every word was aimed at Ganymede like a dagger.
some other young politician Madame was trying to corrupt. But there was some deal made between Director Ando and President Ganymede. The two of you used the Sanir Weeksbooth assassination system to eliminate my father, didn't you?
Ganymede laughed, as if to remind the company that a duke is above spitting.
Don't be absurd. Ando was not yet a director then, and I had never set foot outside this house. How could we use a system we had not even heard of? Marion Cray was a villain and a coward, and I needed no assassin to deal with a worm who would not even face me in an honorable duel.
Director Ando half released the duke, as if testing to see if his haughty calm was real or feigned.
Marion Cray was, as you say, Foster, a politician, a young European and a client of Madame's on the middle level. They sought Danae's hand, but realizing I was the stronger suitor, they disgraced her.
You mean they raped her?
No.
Mason's bronze face set statue hard, but other faces in the chamber seemed unsure.
Isn't that what disgraced means in your crazy ancient prejudice?
Cray broke Danae's heart. Cray wooed her, lured her, made promises to her, pressured her into an illicit meeting with a solemn vow that it would be an innocent one. And there, when the lady would not satisfy Cray's mad, jealous demands of eternal and monogamous fidelity,
he glanced at Golden Ganymede.
Cray attacked her. He was caught in the act, her blood on his fists, and would not accept the consequences like a gentleman, kept abusing her with slanders no gentleman should utter. Ganymede and I were only two of the many who offered to duel to avenge the lady's honor. But Cray refused. When DNA proved the child was Cray's, they went mad with rage, attacked the lady and Madame and others. Madame dismissed them forever from this house, and Cray killed themselves soon after.
That's not an answer. It's a penny dreadful.
Tut,
Dominic warned, his voice deferent here among the princes, but still growling.
There, little cousin. Thou malignest our philosoph. Did Ron never sold for a mere penny?
Carlyle turned to Dominic.
You knew, didn't you? All of this.
Dominic needs to work on hiding his smiles.
Come, this is good news. Thou art a prince, and with Ganymede childless, next in line to be the duke. If thou art acknowledged, thou mayest use one of thine uncle's lesser titles. I looked it up for thee. Count of Laval is the obvious choice, but thou couldst make a case for Marquis de Royan.
Carlyle glared. The true blue diamond sharpness of a scion de la Tremoyille finally awakening in his eyes. Yes, reader. His. This is the moment for which I was commanded to use he for Carlyle. Such are the deplorable laws of aristocracy that a bastard niece might matter little to the duke. But a nephew? With a nephew comes inheritance and barbarian blood upon the ducal throne. If Dominic had another taunt, Mason silenced it with the raising of his merciful right hand.
Cousin Foster, I understand you have been to this house before. You know what is practiced here. Madame and those employed here know how to lure people into their moral palate as well as their sexual palate. The Marion Cray affair was a stock, archaic tragedy, dredged back from darker ages. But stock, archaic dramas are why people come here. And they choose it knowingly.
And you just let Madame do this to people?
I am the law in Alexandria, not here. Madame and those within this house are black laws. Members who patronize Madame's establishment do indeed break laws, sometimes, as Cray did, by committing assault against the laws of Europe. But for the residents of the house itself, only the 8 black laws stand here. If Madame wields sex as a weapon, Romanova has no universal law to contradict. If here affairs of honor are resolved by dueling, and those who refuse the combat as Kray did are expelled from the establishment, Romanova has no universal law to contradict. To ask me to intervene is to ask my empire to raise its hand against Romanova. This you do not want, for 1,000 reasons.
That fear, 1,000 times the scale of petty 710 lists, made the cousin pause.
Exactly. This is a civilized house. My sister did nothing wrong. It was that monster, Kray, that criminal, who brought the poison. Kray, who broke the law, assaulted my sister and tried to destroy her and my family honor.
That isn't true!
Casimir Perry could hold back no more. Ganymede's eyes flashed murder.
What would you know, outsider?
What do I know? I know the two of you conspired to ruin an innocent man. I know Hotaka Ando paid a king's ransom for your services, brought you from Madame, set you up in the outside, built your mansion at La Trumie, arranged your art contacts, your political career, all in return for what you did. I know that whore lying on the sofa over there is not the pure, virginal victim you all pretend. I know Madame knew it all, let it all happen, may even have planned it all themselves. And I know that child is not my son.
No one breathed. Faust moved first, smiling as he checked his gilded pocket watch.
17 minutes and 21 seconds, Madame. I win the bet.
Madame gathered her skirts, the lacy sea tangling as she attempted to navigate around a tower of cheeses.
Oh, were we counting from when you and Perry arrived? Or from when we were all assembled? By the latter count, it's under 10 minutes, so I win.
Perry bristled.
What bet?
Madame's fan hid what must have been a smile.
You were doing so well, Marion. All you had to do was sit quietly through this and no one would have known. You'd finally made it back inside.
Perry paled.
You knew. You knew it was me?
You think I don't check all comers to my house? All comers to this room? A suicide is easy to fake. A face, a voice, easy to change. But there are always traces. I never lose track of anyone.
Delicately as a hummingbird teasing the nectar from a flower's heart, she lifted the silver cover from a tray to reveal a layer cake frosted with the chocolate greeting, "Welcome back, Marion Kray." Faust alone contributed applause. I heard a hiccuped gasp across the line from the anonymous. To my relief, I saw raw and innocent astonishment on Caesar's face. Kosala's too. Earth's mom and stony father stepping close to one another, as if ready to battle back-to-back for their hives and poor Earth's sanity.
Marion Kray?
Ganymede clutched the knife-straight hairpin tighter.
Come, Your Grace. Come.
Casimir Perry is Marion Kray.
Your Grace, I thank you to keep your temper in my house.
Madame did not raise her voice, but its firm timbre made the Duke, her bar child as much as Eloise, tremble. Carlisle Foster had the most right to shudder.
You're my father? Casimir Perry?
Perry stared at Madame like a lunatic at his hallucination.
You knew it was me the whole time. And you let me back in. Let me become Prime Minister. The last time you saw me, I swore I'd never rest until I destroyed you and all that you've created. Why would you?
Because I asked her to, Marion.
The King of Spain stepped forward, gently, as if trying to keep a cornered animal from panicking. The outsider paled.
Your Majesty, why?
Spain smiled.
You were young and foolish and in love, and you were one of the most promising political minds of our generation. You did not deserve to lose it all over one sour love affair. Europe needed you. I needed you. Madame recognized you easily after you took on your new persona as Casimir Perry. Madame told me who you really were, but I asked her not to tell the others. They might not have tolerated giving you a second chance.
Perry Cray scrunched his cuffs with tense hands.
A second chance. And then I cheated you out of your office.
The new Prime Minister was too ashamed to meet the King's eyes.
I rigged the election. I had Zeven Racer cheat so you'd have to drop out. All against my benefactor.
I know.
Spain nodded, as a much-tried father nods.
And I forgive you. The important thing is that Europe be ruled well, not that I rule it. I trusted you to value your second chance, and not to squander it on some petty revenge. Was I wrong?
Cray held his breath like a man about to dive, and I edged closer, ready to grapple if his dive turned violent. It was a strange way to meet him, really. I had not known this man, you must realize. Not as Marion Cray, nor really as Casimir Perry, the Prime Minister whom I had glimpsed here or there upon a balcony when I ran Jehovah's errands at Parliament. No more. I had identified Carlyle's mother by hacking the gag gene records, but had not known the deeper scandal.
I wish you were right, Your Majesty. I wish I could say I had climbed the steps of power with the people's welfare first in my heart, as you have. But at least you're half right. I haven't squandered my second chance. My revenge is nothing petty, but a true apocalypse, which will destroy not only my destroyers, but the world that made them.
His eyes opened, sharp as stars, to lock upon Madame, but Caesar stepped in front of her, a wall of iron gray shielding the salmon petals of her gown.
Be careful whom you include, Cray. A large part of the world is mine, and you, Madame, and Spain should not have hidden such a dangerous situation from the rest of us. Not even in the name of mercy.
Cray laughed. I had not imagined any man could laugh in Caesar's face.
Count yourself lucky, Mason. You're hardly going to suffer. A little global turmoil, that's all. You were party to it too. It's less than you deserve.
Wise men do not intentionally make Mason frown.
I was not party. I was witness. Your violence was intolerable.
I was innocent!
That you were not.
I never raped her!
Cray's hand tightened around his sherry glass, as heavy as a sling stone. But Martin planted himself as a silent wall before his emperor, as Dominic did before Jehovah. He was still with us, our disappointed god, silent in his gravity, like a tombstone in the corner of a playing field. The rest ignored him, or tried to. A glance at him reminded us that we were fools to care about old scandal, when we had just discovered humanity was beyond redemption. But he would not stop us. Rather, like a cliff in a storm, he suffered silently, as yet more proof of his conclusion played out before him. This world is not good, reader. Not as good as he deserves.
I know you didn't rape her.
What?
You didn't rape her. You beat her violently and slandered her.
She slandered me! She accused—
She never said you raped her. You assumed she would. You were so obsessed with expecting that accusation that you never heard the words any of us actually said to you. We said you assaulted her, and you did, with your fists. You fractured her cheekbone, gave her a severe concussion, and could have done much worse. And when we dragged you off her by force, you said the worst things of her that can be said of a lady in this house. Black laws may do what they like here, but as a European, you were bound by law as well as decency. And you went far beyond the bounds of both. Your expulsion was just and reasonable, as prosecution would have been too under the laws of your own hive.
Is that a flinch, Cray? Is that seething brain of yours revisiting old memories and finding certain keywords lacking?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.